Let's create this teal cinematic style look using parallel nodes. This is the clip that we're going to be working with today. This is a stock footage clip from Envato Elements, and it is in Rec.709. The first thing we're going to do is set up our IDT and ODT nodes, which will take this Rec.709 footage, transform it into DaVinci Wide Gamut, so we can get that better color mapping and more flexibility. So I'll go ahead and bring in my color space transform tool. After that, I'll go to input color space and set it to Rec.709, input gamma to gamma 2.4. Then our output color space and output gamma, we'll set it to DaVinci Wide Gamut and DaVinci Intermediate. After that, I'll create a serial node, and then I'll hold down option, click and drag. That'll copy everything that's in this node to this node. And then I'll go over to this node, rename it ODT, and then I'll swap these settings, and we're ready to go. Here we have our IDT node, which is transforming our source footage into DaVinci Wide Gamut, and our ODT node, which is transforming our DaVinci Wide Gamut into our broadcast standard Rec.709 Gamut 2.4. And everything we do is going to be in between these two nodes. I'll go ahead and close this, and let's set up our node tree. So the first thing we're going to add is a section for our primaries and our skin tones. So I'll create a serial node using Option S, and then I'll select Option P to create a parallel node. I'll rename this top node Primaries, and this bottom node I'll rename Skin. After that, we're going to create a parallel node tree column, which is where we're going to create our look. So making sure the parallel mixer is selected, I'll create a node, and then I'll create three parallel nodes using Option P. This top node I'll rename Look. This second node I'll rename Saturation. This third node I'll rename Contrast. And then this last node I'll rename Vignette. After this parallel node structure, we're going to add a few nodes just to take our look a little bit farther. So I'll create a serial node and rename it 2383. I'll create another node and rename that Halation, and then I'll create one more node and rename it Film Grain. In this node here, we're going to drop in a 2383 LUT to give us that nice color palette that the Kodak 2383 look is known for. And then we'll add some Halation and some Film Grain, and that'll be that. Let's adjust our primaries so we get a good base for our look. First, I'll adjust my exposure using my HDR offset wheel as a macro adjustment. So I'll go over to my HDR palette, and then I'll go over to my global wheel, and then I'll mess with my exposure. Just bring it down. When I'm creating my macro exposure adjustment, I like to get these peaks down to around 896 IRE as much as possible without losing detail in my shadow. And I'm liking that right there. If I look over at my waveform, I can see that my shadows are a little too crushed. I'm going to go into my black HDR wheel and I'm going to bring up my black point. I like the contrast that I have in the shot. I like how deep the shadows are, but I don't want the black point to be this low. And if I show a before and after, this is before and after our exposure adjustment. Next, I'll bring up my vectorscope so I can keep an eye on my saturation. And I'm going to bring up my saturation a tiny bit, keeping an eye here on our subject's skin tones. Don't go too much and then bring it back. I'm liking the color separation that I'm getting around here. Maybe just a little lower. And I like that right there. I'm looking at my image and it is looking just the tiniest bit magenta. So I'm gonna grab this temp control here and bring it down just the tiniest bit. And if I hit before and after, I'm liking where that is right there. We've adjusted our primaries. We're gonna skip our skin tones for now and we'll come back to them after we've adjusted our look a little bit. I'm going to go over to the 2383 node, and I'm going to add a Kodak 2383 LUT that I used for working in DaVinci Wide Gamut workflows. So I'll right click here, go down to LUT, go over to DaVinci Wide Gamut Film Looks, and go down to the Kodak 2383 D60 LUT. There's a link in the description of this video where you can download this LUT pack for free. They are basically the Kodak 2383 and Fujifilm 3513 film LUTs that come inside of DaVinci Resolve, just modified to be able to work inside of a DaVinci Wide Gamut color space. For this grade, I just want to borrow the nice color palette that we get from the 2383 film look. So I'll right click on this node, go to composite mode, and set it to color. And that'll give us a nice color palette in our shot and give us essentially half of the look that we want to create. Now that we've created half of our look, let's go ahead and go to the skin tones and adjust them. We'll go over to the hue versus hue curve, and then we'll turn on the anchors for the red hue. If I go over to our subject skin tone and click here, so with this adjustment here, I'm aiming for our skin tones to be lined up more with the skin tone indicator line. But I know that because of this wall here in the back, I am going to be adjusting it a little bit. And that's okay, I'm actually gonna let that happen as a creative choice. So I'll grab this anchor and then start to push it up. Keeping an eye on my vectorscope and the skin tone indicator line. And just making sure that our skin tones just have a little bit more red in them. Right there is okay. I'm gonna go ahead and add the rest of our look, and we can always come back to the skin tones if we need to. So I'll go to my look node, and now we'll use the custom curves to create the rest of our look. With the curves all linked together, I'll go over to my skin tones and select them. And what this is gonna do is create an anchor that'll essentially protect the skin tones. And then it'll make sure that whatever color adjustments I create in these curves sort of pivot around the skin tones and not introduce as much color adjustment into them. Now that I've done that, I'm gonna go over to my red curve, and then I'll grab this point here and I'll bring it down some to introduce some of that nice teal into our shot. I'm liking this right here. I appreciated the color separation I was getting after I adjusted the saturation in our primaries, but now I'm actually going to bring down our saturation just a little bit. So what I'm going to do is go into my saturation versus saturation curve. I'm going to grab this point here and bring it all the way down. And it's going to grab the most saturated parts of my image and just bring them down. I'm going to actually create another point here, move it to the left until I feel like I'm in a nice spot that I like. All the way and then bring it back some. And I'm liking this right here, and I'll leave this here for now. We can always come back to it later. Now I'll go back to my look node and continue to adjust the cyan, and I'm liking that right there. Now that I've done that, I'm going to go over to my blue curve. I'm going to add some warmth to the overall color palette by grabbing the blue curve and bringing it down just a little bit. And you can see just how easily we're creating that nice teal look. And we're easily able to introduce some nice cyan into the shot because we're essentially taking advantage of all these neutrals that we have in our shot, which are free and easy space for adding basically any color that you want. Obviously, you want to make sure that that color decision is informed and you know what color palette you want, and that color palette sort of makes sense. Now that I've done that, I'm going to go back into my skin tones node and I'm going to zoom in on my skin tones a little bit. I'm going to remove this anchor here, as well as this anchor over here, and it's going to allow us to target a little bit more of our skin tones and less so of this peak here, which is essentially this wall back here. But also don't mind that I'm affecting this wall a little bit, and that's because right now this wood back here is pushing more a little bit toward yellow, and I wouldn't mind if it came over to the orange a little bit more just to help with that sort of teal and orange look. And I've made that color decision with this wooden wall here, but right now I'm keeping an eye on those skin tones to make sure that they're sitting in a natural skin tone as much as possible. And I'm liking this point right here. I'll zoom out. And the adjustment is very subtle, but I think our skin tones are sitting in a good spot. You see that there's a little bit of magenta cast still in the image. I'll go back to my primaries. Back to the HDR global wheel. Now I'll introduce some more green. And that'll help with the skin tones a little bit and also help get rid of that magenta cast that we've seen. Now I'll go back to my skin tones node and continue adjusting the skin tones. And actually, I don't feel like it needs that big of an adjustment. I feel like here is a good point for the skin tones. Also, we can see here on our subject's forehead that we have some of that cyan that we introduced, and that's perfect because that helps our subjects sit in the scene and then makes the scene more believable because it makes it feel as though, yes, these subjects are actually in this room that has this teal light. Now that we've adjusted our skin tones, let's go over to the saturation node and let's create some color density. So I'll go over to the saturation versus luminance curve. I'll grab this far right anchor here and bring it all the way down. And what this curve adjustment is going to do is it's going to grab all the hues in our shot that are the most saturated, and it's going to lower the luminance, and it'll create this color density in our image. If I created another anchor and started to push it more to the left, we can see that effect and what it's doing to the image. Obviously, this is too much, but from here, we can go ahead and move it to the right until we're in a spot that we like. I'm actually liking this right here. And it's a great way to just taper off any bright or prominent colors in your shot. And obviously, dense colors are a characteristic of filmic cinematic style looks, so it'll also help with creating that look. Next, we'll go up to our contrast node, and then we're gonna mess around with the contrast a little bit to see if we can push it just a little bit more and get just a bit more pop in our image. And even if it's just a little, that's okay. And I'm liking this right here. I might actually go back into my shadows control and bring them up just a little bit to open up that lower end. Now I'll go back to my contrasts. I am liking that right there. Now let's use this vignette node to shape the light a little bit. So I'll go over to my power windows and I'll create a gradient power window. I'll hit Shift H to see what I'm selecting. And I'll start it down here and leave it there for now. Now I'll go over to my gamma wheel, bring down this a bit, not too much. You wanna try and be as subtle as possible with vignettes and power windows. That's good there. What I'll also do is create an outside node, which will be an inverse of this mask here. And then I'll bring up the shadows in this top area here. I'll go back to my gamma. Negative 0.01 was pretty good. I'm just gonna drag this up now. I'm liking what I'm getting there. And if I toggle the node on and off, you can see that relighting, and it's helping to keep our eye up here. And this is also helping to introduce a little bit more light into our subject over here, because his face was looking a little too underexposed. I'm gonna go back to my saturation, then I'll go to my saturation versus saturation curve, and I'll push this anchor to the left to decrease the saturation a little more. And I like where that's sitting there. Let's finish off this look with some halation and some film grain. So I'll go over to my halation node, and in the effects panel, I'll drag in the DaVinci Resolve halation effect. I'll set our processing color space to DaVinci Wide Gamut. The halation effect in Resolve is not the best, although it can be used to create a decent effect. Here's one way to modify this effect so it's a little bit easier to work with. Find the dye layer reflections, which is essentially the main halation effect. So I'm gonna turn that off by grabbing the strength and bringing it all the way down. I'm gonna go over to the secondary gain. I'm gonna set the strength to 0.5 for now, just so that we can clearly see what's going on. And then I'll select the filter, over to the color wheel, and then I'll select a reddish orange hue. This is looking good right here, and hit OK. And now we'll lower the gamma and the spread to control the look of this halation. You can see how the halation is working. It's nice and subtle, and it's nice and warm. So I'll grab this gamma, increase it a little bit, take the spread, move it around a bit. And then now I'll decrease the strength. I'll also move over a little bit here so I can see how the halation is working on our subject. And I want it just very subtle. And I like how that looks there, giving us a nice little warm glow in our lights, and we are seeing some of the effect around the heads of our subjects. Now let's add some film grain. So I'll go over to my film grain node, and I'll bring in the film grain effect. I'll go to the film grain presets. I'll go down to the 35 millimeter 400T preset, and then I'll zoom in. And if I play this back, you can see that film grain, and it's pretty prominent. We are gonna decrease the strength a little bit, but not just that, we are gonna change how the grain actually looks. Because right now it's looking a little plasticky. And after using the film grain tool a lot, I find that grabbing the texture and bringing it down helps to create a more organic looking texture. And anywhere from around 0.3 to 0.5 usually gives me a good, decent result. What I also like to do is decrease the softness just a tiny bit. I also like to go over to the advanced controls, and then I'll bring down the amount of noise in the shadows and in the midtones, and this will create some depth in the texture of our shot. So typically I'll bring the shadows down quite a bit and grab the midtones, bring them down some, and then leave the highlights where they are. And if I hit before and after, this is giving us nice organic looking grain. The last thing I'll do is grab that grain strength and just bring it down maybe by half, just so that it's not so noticeable. Here is our final result. You can create the same look with a different node tree. You don't need to use parallel nodes, but parallel nodes can be a great way to keep your image flexible and also keep things organized as you're going about color grading your projects. Let me know in the comments if you have any questions. And as always, thank you for watching.